Toyota is smashing their own production record this year. They're going to produce over 10 million vehicles for the first time. No other automaker in the history of mankind has done that. But today, we're not only going to go over the sales, we're going to bust out the spreadsheet of spreadsheets, the father of all spreadsheets, and break down sales per region, production per region. Make sure you have your snacks and drinks, and let's freaking go. The parts shortages are over, ladies and gentlemen, and if you're excited for better availability for Toyotas, smash the heck out of that like button. Make sure you subscribe because I'm heading to Japan in a month or so in October for the Japan Mobility Show, where they're going to show all these amazing new cars from Toyota, Honda, Mazda, Nissan, etc. You won't want to miss it, bringing you hands-on coverage while I'm snacking on that delicious sushi. This is the first time Toyota's ever going past the eight-figure milestone, that 10 million mark. Their target is to produce about 3.4 million Japanese-made Toyota and Lexus vehicles, and then roughly 6.8 million units overseas, for increases of 30% increase for Japan compared to last year and 10% increase outside of Japan compared to last year. Now, in order to maintain their monozukuri craftsmanship, you could say, well, the top of them are the Takumi, right? But in order to provide and maintain the world's best made automobiles, Toyota believes it needs to domestically produce minimum 3 million automobiles. And that's why I think Akio Toyota, his swan song was the crown lineup. Four crown models produced domestically in Japan for the world to sample, taste, and enjoy the greatness of Japanese-made autos, not only sharing the greatness of those cars, but maintaining those jobs, maintaining the skills and craftsmanship of Japanese-made vehicles. The Crown lineup embodies that. Make sure to watch my review on the Crown that I just did. Now, for the first 7 months of the year, production volume has been up 12% to 5.7 million. But guess what? The last 5 months of the year, they're planning on an average of 900,000 vehicles produced per month. The previous record that Toyota set was in 2019 of 9.05 million. This is a first year, like I said, eight figures, 10.2 is the benchmark that they're trying to hit. This is just a short-term success for them because next year they're expecting an additional 500,000 cars. Medium-term plan foresees a production volume of roughly 10.7 million vehicles next year and about 11 million units in 2025. So all those haters out there saying, hey, Toyota is shrinking, you know, they can't keep up with the EV, switchovers in China or even in the United States. Not so fast. Toyota doesn't make bold claims without backing them up. Sometimes, you know, they're not perfect. Some of their EV estimates in the past have been incorrect, but don't be shorting Toyota on this. I think absolutely they will be able to hit 11 million vehicles produced in 2025. And they want to gradually raise the domestic production volume to more than 3.5 million units by 2025. When I hear that, I hear greater availability of Lexus models made at the Tohoku plant, like the IS, the LC, the LS, stuff like that. But more importantly for the masses, I think that's more 4Runners, that's more Land Cruisers, and more Crowns and Priuses that are all built over there. And for now, all Corolla hybrids are built over there too, until they start electrifying in the United States, which I just think it's only a matter of time, maybe 2025, 2026, they start doing that for the Corolla. But the Crown, the Prius, the Land Cruiser, the 4Runner, in my estimation, will all always be built over in Japan, and the volume is just going to keep increasing year over year. Toyota also has a global share of 60% hybrids. So that's not saying that 60% of their lineup and total volume is hybrid. That's saying that out of all the hybrids for sale in the world, 60% of those hybrids are Toyota badged or Lexus badged models. So they absolutely own and dominate the hybrid market out there globally. They're expecting hybrid demand to reach over 8 million vehicles in 2025. That's an increase of 85% compared to last year, where they produced less than 4 million. 8.06 million times 60% means almost 4.9 million hybrids from Toyota by 2025 in just 2 years. Toyota Chinese sales sunk in July 15%. This is the big red flag for them. So we'll talk about that today with the mega spreadsheet. Toyota is looking to sell 1.5 million EVs by 2026. But in the January through July period of this year, they've only sold about 50,000. So, I mean, we know that production here in the United States is going to skyrocket with the Kentucky plant coming online with BEV assembly lines. At least two of the three, I think, are going to be switched over to BEVs. I think you're going to have the Camry on one assembly line, which is not BEV. It'll be hybrid only from what I know. Other two lines, you're going to have a Lexus BEV line, and then you'll have probably a mixed BEV line with Subarus and Toyotas and Lexuses rolling off, maybe with the three-row crossovers. And you're also going to have potentially the BZ4X and Subaru Solterra rolling off that same assembly line. So crazy sort of flexibility with the amount of models rolling off the Kentucky plant in the coming years for EVs. For July 2023, Toyota had a record for worldwide sales, up to 918,000. They also had a July production record worldwide and production record outside of Japan for a total of 918,000. And heading on over to Mega Spreadsheet, guys, if you don't have your snacks and drinks yet, if you haven't taken your potty break, you might want to do that, and let's buckle in. So what we're looking at here is total sales for July of 2023 and the percentage that it is up compared to last July. Mexico is crushing it, up 44% compared to last year. For 2023 versus 2022, though, so far this year, Toyota's only up about 0.4%. Why is that? Well, they were still recovering in the first half of this year. And you can see the big rebound now is that they're positive, and that's going to just gain and build momentum as we close the year out. So by the end of the year, they might be up 5 to 10%, something like that, here in North America. What about Latin America? Well, in July, they're down 3.3%. They're up, though, so far in the year, about 3.6%. Europe sales, Europe Toyota's killing it. Now, their volume is still pretty small, 92,000 compared to, let's say, 224,000 in North America and 269,000 in Asia. But Europe, though, high ticket items, their cars sell for a lot over there. The market's more of a premium ticket item place. They are up 18% for the month of July and up about 5% on the year. So the European market for Toyota and for Lexus continues to grow, even though they are still one of the smaller players over there. People really appreciate. So which countries are they doing well? Russia, rest in peace. But what are the other countries that are doing well? UK is up about 10%. France up 32%. I know France likes a smaller car, so maybe the Yaris Cross, the Yaris doing really well there. Italy down 40%. Well, Italy's kind of a dying country in some ways. The population shrinking. Interesting. Germany up 20% there, Spain up 30% there, and the rest of the countries up about 30%. So very, very impressive for the month of July in Europe. What's interesting is that the UK is leading so far this year for Europe in terms of who's doing the best. And they also have, the UK has the highest volume of Toyotas sold, with France behind them, then Italy, then Spain, then Germany. All right, let's look at what's going on in Asia, because this is a bit worrying. And the reason is that the Chinese market is the Wild West of automobiles. So many startups, so much change in a short amount of time over to electrification, so many price wars going on, technology moving really, really quickly over there. Toyota's down in Asia 1.5%. down, but that's for the year. On the month, it's worse, down 7%. And if we look at China and Hong Kong, minus 15%. Smaller markets like Pakistan, down 43%. Vietnam, down 30%. We know VinFast is doing selling a lot in their home market. Korea, South Korea, though, it's a tiny market because the Hyundai and Kia are huge there, but Toyota's actually doing fairly well there, up 52% for the month and up 77% on the year. But it's not looking good for the Chinese market, for any of the Japanese automakers. I looked at Nissan, they're down like 44% or something like that for the month. Just terrible. If we put China, Pakistan, and Vietnam aside, and maybe even Thailand. Thailand's not doing that well because the Chinese are starting to infiltrate that market as well, I think. So Indonesia still up 6%. Philippines is up 17%. Taiwan up 10%. 8% for Malaysia. 77% for Korea, like I mentioned. India up 32%. Now, India has never been a strong place for Toyota. Suzuki, for example, Suzuki is partially owned by Toyota. Suzuki has a very strong foothold in India, but Toyota's been kind of riding on the success of Suzuki and their partnership, and that's been helping them immensely lately. So they're up about 32% on the year in India. But still, look at how small Toyota is in India, Indonesia, Thailand. These are all pretty big markets, and they're about the same size of Canada, which has a much smaller population. We know that the affluence in Canada is much different than some of those Asian nations, though. All right, let's get into Japan, the Japanese market there, their production habitat at home. They're up 33% on the year, 35% on the month. So things have pretty much rebounded in Japan completely, it seems like. Sales are up year on year as a result of a rebound from the impact of parts supply shortages. So that's pretty much good. That's great to see. Australia is down 13% on the year. Wow, that's really surprising. But they're up 2.4% on the month. I know Toyota is huge in Australia, very, very prominent with the Land Cruiser nameplate as well. So Australia, about the size of Canada, I think, population-wise, and the volume kind of reflects that as well, both of them being around 20,000 units per the month. Middle East, lovers of, you know, the large body on frame vehicles, they're off-roaders. It's up 27% on the month, up 14% on the year. Africa, crushing it. They love their big Toyota off-roaders too, with the Land Cruisers and whatnot. So Africa up 35% on the month, 9% on the year, but it tells you how big of a market South Africa is compared to the rest of the continent, because South Africa alone outsells the rest of the continent combined. Since Toyota's breaking the production numbers, what's going on across the world? Up 8.1% in North America. The production is up about 3% in Latin America. Production is up about 2% in Europe, 2% in Asia, despite the Chinese market in a free fall right now. Production volume down 23% for the month and down 10% on the year. So things are looking worse. But it's not just for Toyota, like I said, it's all the Japanese automakers, and things are very uncertain with the Chinese economy as we go forward, at least in the near future. So Japanese market up 30% for the year when it comes to production volume. That's great to see. Now we're going to get a lot of those Japanese made Toyotas and better availability here stateside. If we look at sales of electrified vehicles, they break it down from hybrid to mild hybrid, which we don't have any mild hybrids that I'm aware of Toyota vehicles here in the United States or North America. Plug-in hybrid sales, which we want more of those, and more. We just want more of all of this because we want more electrified Toyota vehicles. They are fantastic. Well, maybe not the battery electric vehicles, but their hybrids and plug-in hybrids are arguably the best in the world. And that's why they have 60% of the market too. If they didn't have a good product, people wouldn't buy them. All right, hybrids here. Total so far this year, worldwide sales, 1.8 million so far for the first half, right? Because we're looking at July. And then worldwide sales of hybrids up 22.2%. Oh, sales inside of Japan for the hybrids is up nearly 70%. And outside of Japan for their hybrids, about 10% increase. We're not going to talk about mild hybrids since we don't have any of those here stateside. But their plug-in hybrids, they need more Prius Primes out there. They need more Lexus plug-in hybrids. And they need more RAV4 Primes. And they need more Primes of their... They just need to prime everything in their lineup, from their pickup trucks to every K-platform vehicle. The B and C-platform vehicles, just not cost-effective because those are lower-ticket item vehicles. But their K-platforms, they should all have a version, a prime version or a plug-in hybrid version, depending on where you're at in the world. All right, worldwide sales for the plug-in hybrids is up 21%. Inside of Japan, their plug-in hybrids are up 171%, maybe largely due to the Prius, hard to say. Sales outside of Japan only up 5.5%. So not the sort of plug-in hybrid volume to satiate the demand, that is for sure. Fuel cells, whatever, not going to talk about them. Battery electric, where are they going? Well, their volume's up 429% worldwide, only up 50% inside of the country of Japan. Outside of Japan, it is up 476%. So far, they've sold about 53,000 battery electric vehicles worldwide. And in just 3 years, they want to sell 1.5 million. Let's be generous and say they get to 80,000 battery electric vehicles this year. They have to increase 18 to 19 times their volume of battery electric vehicles between now and 2026 to hit the 1.5 million vehicles. It's possible. It just doesn't seem likely. Now, how's my baby? How's Lexus doing? If you guys don't know, why is Lexus important to me? I used to sell for Lexus. That's what this channel started on, was covering Lexus news and doing reviews on Lexus vehicles. So Lexus always has a near and dear place in my heart. So worldwide sales of Lexus up 22%, 453,000 so far this year, getting close to a million Lexus is worldwide. I think by 2030, when they want to be mostly battery electric in all their main markets, they're aiming for a million EVs that are just Lexus EVs by 2030. So, you know, it would essentially be their entire lineup right now being sold as an EV plus some in terms of raw volume. Inside of Japan, Lexus, not that big of a brand, but it is up 142%. That's impressive. Sales outside of Japan, 393,000 so far, up 13%. In the North American market, nearly 200,000 units, and they typically battle it out with China, at least until recently, because check this out, guys. Look how close they were in the full year. So if we look at 21 and 2022, that was the full year of Lexus vehicles being sold in North America. 331,000 divided by 263. So only about 25, 26% more sold in North America than in China just 2 years ago. So remember 25%, because we're going to do 195 divided by 120. Now, if my math's right, there's about 62% more Lexuses being sold out in North America compared to China. So there's a huge drop in Lexus volume in China. I know this is over-encompassing Asia, but China is by far the largest market in the Asian umbrella. Their growth stopped in Asia and mainly in China in 2021. They plateaued then to 263, and it fell off to 200 in 2022. And in 2023, it's going to be even below that. Maybe not by a whole lot, but they're still decreasing in desirability, mainly in China. Oceania has rebounded. They're up 143% there. Europe has rebounded up 113%. So the Lexus brand growing massively there. Latin America, it's only 300 units so far this year, but up 100% there too. Middle East up over 110%. Africa's up 47%. So Lexus as a brand is having a major, major comeback so far this year across the globe and massively everywhere, just not in China for the most part. But I believe I've run out of spreadsheets, at least the ones I want to go over. So thank you guys for watching. It was a lot of fun breaking down the sales, the production, the exports, and the better availability coming for Toyota and Lexus models due to the lack of hiccups in the production system, or should I say the supply chain system. So hopefully that remains true as we go forward. Forever, we never have any supply shortages ever again, because the consumer has just been getting screwed as a result of low availability of vehicles. So we want more availability, we want more choice, we want more competition, and that leads to more competitive pricing and more competitive products as well. Thank you guys for watching. I'm heading to Baltimore, Maryland in just a couple days to drive the new Kona. So make sure you are subscribed, hit the bell icon for that coverage, and I'll catch you in the next one. Have a great day and peace.